get on with it and we can finally explain what Zentradi are. So that are goddamn bullshit. So, like all stupid idiot geniuses, here's Carlos Action Jr. playing chess, and his opponent is Lelouch. He asks how a mere schoolboy managed to score getting a chess game with the richest man in the world, but Lelouch refuses to say. The stakes of the game are Carlos's personal bank card and details against Lelouch's life. He almost wouldn't have taken the wager, and Lelouch says, because you can't put a value on human life? And Carlos says, quite the opposite, I don't think your life is worth nearly as much as my bank account. But Carlos explains that the only person he's ever lost to in chess is Prince Schneisel, who is the second prince of the Holy Britannian Empire. But, as you expect from Carlos's face there, Carlos doesn't know that Lelouch knows Schneisel very well, and beats Schneisel at chess quite often. And if Carlos can't beat the prince, then he hasn't a chance in hell against old Lulu. And as promised, Carlos hands over his card, and then says, but I never said I'd give you the pin number 2! Owned, idiot. Monkey's paw. But then the Loose Free Britannia commands you, answer all of my questions. Does the brain whammo on him. And he gets the pin number. And then, satisfied that the chaos will wipe all of Carlos' memories, Lelouch leaves. He's caught by C2, and he said that she had as little trouble getting into the office as he did, because he'd gassed everybody out of his way. And she considers her and him to be partners in crime, so she wants to keep tabs on what he's up to and keep him out of trouble. But Lelouch doesn't thank her because he's a jerk. They recap the code Gaius thing. There's princes and princesses of Britannia fighting over the throne, and Emperor Charles is behind it all, and Charles uses this survival of the fittest thing to keep Britannia's ruling class strong and by culling the weak. And Lelouch is driven mostly because he believes that that's what killed his mother and destroyed his and his sister's life, and destroying Britannia is his path to freedom, where he doesn't have to worry about being discovered and being used as a political hostage ever again. So the power of absolute obedience is key. And C2 expects Lelouch to fill his side of the pact between them at some point. And no matter how many times he says, so what is it anyway? She's just like, nope, I won't tell you till the time is right. And he tries to gaze her, and it doesn't work on her at all. And she's recovered from fatal wounds, and all things considered, Lelouch calls her a dang witch. But he does owe her forgiving him the magic power to do something with his life. But with Carlos's money and a tip from Boatman, he can get his hands on some new nightmares from Kyoto. And that means big things that are about to happen. Maybe big enough to change the world. And all according to Zero's plan. Damn, I guess the chat blew up. Thanks, Twitch. Meanwhile, everybody's all got together at the Dragon's Hive, and introductions are going on all around. And Ozma is introducing and explaining the Macross and how it's a big thing. people from space doing things? Michel Blanc. Luca Angelino. Okay, Angeloni is his name. And there's Clan, and she says she's the Clan. And Wera's like, wow! What's the deal? And she's like, I'm 19, alright? I'm a 19-year-old woman, I'm a sergeant. Or whatever her rank is. I think she's a captain, actually. She's like, I'm 19. It's like, wait, what? But you look like that. And he's like, yeah, it's a disease. I've got a genetic condition, all right? And then Michelle explains how Zentradi are 60 feet tall, and to interact with humans, they shrink themselves down, doing a process called being micronized. And Clan's Micron, for some reason, rather than just being a human-sized version of herself, it looks like that. And everybody makes fun of her, and she's super embarrassed the whole time, and she's really sensitive about it, as you'd expect. And then Lamia and Nene are like, all right, we're also Zentradi, but we don't have that problem, we're just tiny versions of ourselves. And the deal with the Zentradi I'll explain in the stage, because it's cool and interesting. And meanwhile, Akagi's like, and who's this? That beautiful lady. And he's like, I'm not a woman! But it's a dude! And it's like, yep, that's Alto, the beautiful princess. And he's Alto Saotome. And then Ryoma is like, Saotome? Don't suppose you know much science. And they explain that in their universe, Saotome is the name of an old Kabuki legacy. And then, Hiro and Duo do their catches. I'm a pilot. I'm not Kabuki, I'm pilot. And then eventually we're going to get to Hiro. Yeah, Hiro and Duo are going to fill us in about what happened in the Area 11 thing. And here's Simon and Roshu. And Simon is like, first he's mind blown that there's stuff on the surface, but now he's found out that there are people living beyond the sky too? Like, holy shit, what's up with that, right? Kamen has no idea what's going on, and he doesn't care. And Yoko has no idea what's going on, but she's going to do her homework and figure it out. And then Khan is like, study? What the heck's that? Ru comes in and delivers the bad news. It's Ru. Ru-ri-ru. Ru-ri-ru-ri. It's like, Area 11 is having problems. The WLF and the Japanese Liberation Front are moving in on Mount Fuji. And, any team up of Japan's biggest and rowdiest rebellion and the jerks of the WLF is going to be big trouble. So they've made hostages of the Sakuradite production summit. Fucking Sakuradite, the worst fucking named bullshit ever. And, of course, some of the civilians at the site are the student council. So there's Nina, there's Shirley. And they're not even Sakuradite related. They just were hiking on the mountain and then got rounded up by this terrorist fucker. And then the guards start ranting about how the world is full of sheeple like them. And it's all their fault. And then But then Alina says that they may be playing at changing the world, but swinging power around blindly just causes violence to spread. And the terrorist is like, "You trying to be like Hiro Yui or something?" He's like, "Damn, what's that dude I know called Hiro?" Meanwhile, Nina accidentally calls this terrorist, the Japanese terrorist man, an 11, which, you know, is a slur. So, you know. And he's about to, "What the fuck you call me? I'm Japanese, not an 11, fuck you." And she starts flipping her shit. But then Euphemia steps in and defends her, and he's like, "Yo, chill out." And she demands to speak with the terrorist leader. Because she's Euphemia Libertania. And like, oh shit, she's actually like really important. Back in the ghetto, Zero's giving the resistance their new uniforms. The Australians, Vanilla, Kokona, and Goat, and Kiriko all, like, decline. And Zero's fine with that, but he demands Kiriko at least comes along for the fight. And Zero even has a present for him. It's a slightly better scope dog. And when they talk about the uniforms, they're to make the world notice them. And Tamaki figures that means they're going to hook up with the old JIM at Mount Fuji. And he's half right. Zero and his crew are going to Mount Fuji, but not to join with those jokers, but to take them down, because we are not a resistance. We're crusaders for justice. There he is. Let me just do this, because Twitch is being fucking awful to me. Fucking Watta laughing at Clan explaining about Zentradi and humans and how they interbreed. It's why one of them shrinking. They just climb inside their vagina or whatever. That's fucked up, dude. But back at Dragon's Hive, Otsuka's explaining that the Peace Council has proposed a new task force to include Celestial Being, the SMS, and the Crushers. Sumeragi, like, not super sure that working for working for the UN will go well with for either side, but Otsuka just says Elgin Roderick's got a plan. And then she says that she doesn't want to cause any unnecessary disturbance. And Jeffrey then goes, "Ah, so that means you've caused necessary disturbance." But they explain about Vader. And the catalyst for the business is what's going on at Fuji 11, and Elgin Roderick has asked the new squad to go deal with it. And it's our first mission as a team, and it's going to be some pretty sensitive stuff, but, you know, we'll try our best. The commanders start to plot a plan when transmission from Boatman. It's a message from Zero, and then, what does he say? We're not allowed to know yet. It's Cornelia. Zero contacts Cornelia at the Britannian base, and she reminds him, through her gritted teeth, that he's got some damn nerve to call her while being public enemy number one, and also the murderer of her very own brother. And he just says, "Cornelia, who would you choose? Clovis, who's dead? Or Euphemia, who's alive?" And her reaction speaks volumes, and one of them is, "Oh, why Cornelia won't mount an attack?" Because she doesn't want to risk Euphemia getting hurt. And Lush knows how long Euphemia has been Cornelia's weakness. So he offers to save old Euphemia himself. And thus we get Chapter 13, The Black Knight. Oh, they just a whole bunch of drop frames where I guess Twitch is just fucking up. So here's a newscaster talking about how there's all these dang terrorist robots everywhere. Goddamn genocide runs and everything. And, here's Lloyd. He's like, wow, look at all this stuff the JIM and the WLF have pulled together. And his goal is to get the hostages free so that Cornelia can make her move. And Suzaku, being their ace in the hole, has noticed his friends, Rilina and Nina and Millie and Charlie and all that jazz, are on the list of hostages. But just as he's about to make his move, Zero appears at the entrance to the thing. And he's like, it's Zero! Zero has appeared at the entrance to the facility! Not even in a mecha. And then Lelouch is wondering whether the terrorists will assume he's one of them or try to take him out, but he predicts at the very least they won't be able to resist meeting the legendary Zero. And all the news people went wild. As he predicted, the leader, Kusakabe, meets with him. And the Zero says that the JIM's methods go against his goals. And Kusakabe says that he's not really into the WLF's ideals, but power's power. So Zero asks if Kusakabe will join him. And then Kusakabe says, if you remove your mask. So Zero puts one last thing on the counter. And he says, what do you see at the end of your path? And Kusakabe says, to make them realize that the Japanese aren't down yet. And Zero says, a romantic answer, but outdated. And when the terrorist moves in on him, clicks a little button and a little window in his helmet that covers his eye opens up, and he drops Sergeus to where he commands them all to die. And as they do, we move in our new nightmare frames. Zero reports that he's freed the hostages and gives the orders to get them the hell out of there. The like regular weird people were Britannians who refused to follow instructions from Elevens, and Millie and Rillian are like, they're trying to save your life, like they're like, get out of this war zone. You're like, I'm not gonna do what you say, fuck off, like shut up and get going. Euphemia meets Zero on the way out and he lets slip her, you haven't changed, but then he says that he spoke with Cornelia, and then he boasts that he killed Clovis and that he went out and that Clovis went out begging for his life with the same mouth he used to order the death of Elevens. But that's not why he killed Clovis. He says, I killed him because he was a child of Britannia. Speaking of which, aren't you one too? But I won't hurt you now, for now. Go. Zero. And then these terrorist dudes are like, what's going on? And he says, attention, WLF terrorists. Commander Kusakabe and his men have taken their lives. I believe they realized their own foolishness. Have you? And then the Lancelot deploys, start shooting. And then Zero says, welcome, White Knight of Britannia. I see you found a queue to enter on, but I'm afraid there's no role for you on my stage. There is already a rook to protect the king. And then we show up. Right on time. So try to... Luca, Clan, Alto, yeah, sure. Otsuka is leading the field personally, and asks the terrorists to surrender. But him being here is part of Elgin's plan, and showing himself makes the whole operation fall under the Peacekeeping Council's jurisdiction, meaning Britannia can't, like, try and fucking murder us. The UN can claim Poison will die, I believe, by saying Celestial Being just showed up. But the real genius here is Zero, of course, because no one thought he'd actually be able to free the hostages like he said he would. Everyone thought he was full of shit. Taki and Ogi leave, and Zero gets his own new dang robot. And Suzuku's orders are to work with the UN, ignore Celestial Being and the Resistance, and focus purely on the WLF. That's it, everybody got some upgrade. Now we gotta fucking fight. Take out the terrorists. Yeah, indeed, Hart. Can't believe how good this is, and we've gotta kill everybody in 3 turns. What did you miss? You missed some shitty space adventures. Nothing much. And here's Zero in his new ride. It's not very good, but he's got a new ride. But the real king baby here is Callan's upgrade, which is really good. And Kiriko's robot, which is mostly the same, but with slightly better stats. Find Callan. I'm not scared of anything now, I have the Gurren. I'll fight with Zero to take back Japan from Britannia. And now she just boils everything with her magic hand. Is there a rebel or communist? Probably rebel, because there's not really any communists in this game. No matter how much you want them to be, there aren't any. So, everything's going exactly as planned, and if you win this, my plan will advance to the next phase. Wait for me, Nunnally. I'll make this world one where you can live in peace. So, listen to this boy's voice. Who had these fucking balls? And now, listen to this boy's voice. They are the same boy. They are both voiced by Jun Fukuyama. Guy's got range. You have missed 2 stages. Well, that's not really what I wanted to happen, but it's fine. Simon in front. Not Simon needs the injection, but you know. Bro, they're not gunmen, but they sure look strong. And Kamala, Don't chicken out now, Simon. We're ready for anything this great wide world throws at us. But what you gotta do is get your energy deep in your gut and break whatever's down there. I'll show you how. Oi, oi, oi. I don't care what's up. You monkeys can't play dirty and get away with it. We're the Gurren Gang. Chief Badass Cameron and his little bro Simon. And you're done now that we're here. Come at me if you're ready for it. All that happened in the two stages was we got introduced to the Macross people in their planes and the Vajra and their space bugs. And like, that was it really. And singing. But yeah, so in Macross, Clan is a Zentradi. She's actually a Lady Zentradi, which are technically called Meltrandi. But Zentradi are a race of giant people who are built for war, and pretty much that was it, really. Like, that's all they've ever known. They are a made race. It turns out in the Macross universe, humans are also a constructed race made by the proto-culture, which is just people who lived billions of years ago and seeded life all over the universe, and they made the Zentradi for fighting and defending everything, and they made humans for like doing everything else pretty much. And the deal in the original Macross is Zentradi have no culture. There aren't even, like, all they do is fight. They don't know what art is, they don't know what flying is. Well, they're not flying, they don't know what painting is, they don't know what drawing is, they don't know music. Okay, here's Joma. Look what you're doing. You think you have any right to talk about justice? I'm gonna beat this Twisted Crusade right out of your head. I can't change Jeffrey's theme to Zengar's in this game, but that's what I changed it to in Z3. Yeah, like, they just didn't have art, didn't have music, didn't have poetry, they didn't know about kissing and sex to make babies, didn't know what babies were because they're all, like, ever so slightly genetically modified clones. And one of them ends up infiltrating the humans and does a knife fight with a man and loses, and he's like, all I do is lose to you and it makes me feel weird, what's up with that? And then they end up getting together and they have a baby, and she's like, wow, this is fucked up, look at this weird little fella. And she throws it around the room because she doesn't get it. And then she ends up averting war. Like, they avert war by one lady sings and all of the giant people are like, holy shit, what the fuck's that? Can't believe it. Then the main character and the single lady have a smooch in front of the giants, like, what the fuck are you doing? Like, we're kissing, this is how we show we love each other. Like, what's love? And they have to explain it. And the lady with the baby says, check this out. Look at this, it's a baby. Like, what the fuck's a baby? Like, it grew inside me. It's a little me. It's small now, but one day it might even be bigger than me. And like, no way, that's like a toy, that's a doll or whatever, fuck you. But then it moves and cries and they're like, holy shit, maybe she's telling the truth. What the fuck? Can't believe it. Mind's blown about this fucking baby. And a lot of them then go, I ain't fighting that shit. That's fucked up. This dark sorcery they got going on. It's fine, Crow. Yeah, it's Crow. WLF, Japan Independence Movement. I figured the only thing impressive about them was their names. But where are they getting all the firepower? They're getting money from somewhere? Pissing me off!
Hail Mary!
Hail Mary! But then, they end up finding out that there's women ones called Meltrandi. And they're like, man, you know what? Just fighting all the time sucks. What if we did other stuff? So they just do other stuff and they mix with humans, and because they're both made by the proto-culture from the same genetic stock, they can interbreed. And Michelle is like half Zentradi, which is why he's got pointy ears. And Clan is obviously full Zentradi because she's fucking massive. And it's good as hell. I have to find a picture of the fucking baby. And by the baby, I mean the dude going, holy shit, look at that, like, fucking kissing him. What the? Koji is up here. Yeah, the dark sorcery known as Baby Maker. It's fuck, they're like, what the fuck? They're like, well, first you take your dick, and then you put it in there. Wait, what? What, you do the what? With what? Fuck. But it's Koji. You want people to pay attention? Do it right. But if you're going to take hostages, I ain't listening. That's as bad as Dr. Hell taking over the world. But that's why they make the Macross planes turn into giant robots, so they can fight the Zentradi on, like, equal footing. Yeah, here we go, here's the picture. Look at this fucking dude, look how horrified he is at those people kissing. He's like, holy shit, what are you doing? What are you doing to that woman's mouth? That's where food goes. You're sticking your tongue in there? What the heck? Let's find Alto. So Alto internally, the Earth sky is wide, but I don't want to fly it to a fight like this. Dang it! What's the matter with me? Poor Alto. He's thinking about girls. I have no idea what you're talking about. Not even one little bit do I understand. Akagi's down here. So here's Aoyama. Thy gods are Herodine's fighting system. We've gotten to the point where the UN's making us fight terrorists. And Ibuki, if this keeps up, who knows what we'll find ourselves fighting. And then Akagi, don't matter to me! Our job's to protect the people, no matter what we have to fight for it. How the hell do you stay so positive? We've been putting up with it, but it's getting a bit old. Aw, oh, come on, Aoyama. You have to do it, so you might as well have fun. Let's go! Kage's got the right idea. Yeah, Shiro. Yeah, we'll do all that, but remember. No spoilers, but yeah, we'll do that. With the secret of the face. Classic secret of the face. Yeah, Sure, go for it. Go for it. Nice work, man. Genocidron. We're fighting for justice and freedom. In my robot, the Genocidron. Nah, dude. I think you might be a baddie. Actually. Straight up. Original or the OVA? I don't know. Like, they're both good. They're both good in different ways. Which one I think's better. Here's Owie. They're just sad little terrorists. No playing nice. I'm gonna go wild all over you. Bullshit, but yeah, like now they're learning culture from people, they've been learning culture from people, and they're getting on having a good time. And then there are other threats that show up that are possibly they're either proto culture related in that they're other things made by the proto culture, or they're things that the proto culture made humans and Zentradi to stop. The mission is you just gotta blow everybody up. It's got to blow everybody up in 3-player turns. So, nothing too tough. Obi only has one accelerator in for a really long time. Get him, Crow, baby! A bayonet spiker, ready? Fucking Crow. Go! He's from Chicago, it's alright. It makes sense for him to speak loads of English. Just loves to eat a hot dog and watch the big game. Oh yeah, and this idiot's over here, right? I forgot. Me, 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 me. Zero, assassinated Prince Clovis and led the resistance against Britannia. He's also fighting the JIM and WLF. What's he playing at? What's he planning? Most importantly, what does he want? It's a tough one. Hmm. If Setsuna had come, he'd talk about how the WLF have power and funds to spare. Could they have other backers? Yeah, punch him, dude. Get him, little fella. Yeah, that's what I expected out of that. Give me my best. Inakaruma is like flaming wheel kick, something like that. It's like burning wheel kick or something, but it's obviously almost Inazuma kick. That dude who's getting fucking murdered. This dude's gonna get murdered too by the big boy. It's incredible energy. Crank it to the red for the photon power beam. Yeah, and Kiriko, buddy. I appreciate them putting a thing that looks like a helmet on the big gun head. Impossible! He's just a shitty little dude, and I've got a gun for a head. Now I'm dead. That was a good song that dude came up with. Tier in long range. It's like the Fritz helmet, but gun face. How is this dude doing? Sniping me and being rude. Eat this! Little damage to the actuator. It happened. They had attacked from too far away. Yeah, Kiriko is a man of few words until he meets Shaco, and then Shaco just does all the shit that Kiriko's been doing to everybody else where they talk to him, and then he ignores them to Kiriko, and Kiriko's like, man, it's really irritating. Am I really like that? Piss. It was back alley Space Boys by the Cobra Killers or whatever. Why are you getting murdered, dude? Don't understand. No, he doesn't have his armored magnum yet. He'll have the armor. He gets it soon, but he doesn't use it yet. The gods prevail, just ticking up as that man gradually does like 7% of our health is damage every time. Bonk, got him. I mean, we can shoot you from all the way over here, dude, so I mean, bring it if you want. Alright, well, if that's the only way you can get on with, might as well get on with it then. To go, die guard, man cannon, launch. I will take your life. Yeah, dude regrets. Oh, good. More attacking people who can't do shit. Nice work, terrorist. But you think you're real smart and cool, don't you? The bomb seems really good. It's really good. It has a different one in Z3, but I just change it to Lullaby Steel because it's so good. This fucking Nagai. Never even seen him before. Well, I can tell he sucks. From just one whiff. How you doing, buddy? We did it! We're alive! For the Gurren Gang, let's go! Blomp. So it has three eyes. Yeah, it's got three camera lenses that spin round. Damn, I'm glad that you're here. This is what you deserve. Special killing dagger. Okay, you radiation wave that nerd. I'm doing alright, but I'm real tired. So I might have to call it before going for like 6 more hours. I might have to call it after a mere 3 more. It's pretty shining finger, right? She's not even fucking upgraded. You mean I was sending out these nerds and they're not even fucking upgraded? I did wonder why he got so owned. Give him the blammo, Kiriko. Bum, bum. This is the first time we've seen them on this route, though. That's why they're not upgraded. Is this all the Genocidron can take? Got him. My Genocidron! I just wish that you didn't have a robot called the Genocidron. To make everybody that little bit stronger. Big Drillums! Well, he did just under double their goddamn health. Actually, I think he did just over, like, 30 over or something. Pretty good boy, all things considered. The chest sunglasses are extremely powerful. The goddamn golden boomerang. Wait till you see the real bullshit he pulls with that. It's outrageous. Yeah, that's what I expected out of Ryoma. With his plus 30% damage. His ace bonus is like when he's above 150, they change it in later games. Because it's not like that's too good to only when he's at 170 or above. Can you handle this? Alright, pretty funny. Shitty Jellybean robot from hell. Damn, right in where it still could be if it wasn't a half worm abomination. Hato wears a vest, he wears a goddamn waistcoat. A gilet, because he's a styling dude. He pulls off the old salmon shirt and suspenders look. Pretty good. Wee 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 wee. Thank you, Sayaka. Crap! damn it. He died as he lived. Making bad decisions about being a terrorist. I should have cheered again. Nah, this was actually doesn't get the cape and helmet. He's not a fancy boy. These boys don't wear pilot suits, except Ryoma, who does, but underneath all of his outfit because he's an idiot. Actually, he doesn't, does he? He doesn't wear a flight suit. He does in New Getter Robo. He wears the flight suit underneath. Where's the bad man? Is that the only bad man left? Alright, well, I guess that's the only bad man left. XP, but why not? Go, Simon, John, Peter. All Musashi's a badass. All of them. Every single one. That's our point got. We did it. We got him. Mars didn't even get to attack a man, so he didn't even get to see the bullshit he says where he's like, "You're doing it wrong." Oh, no! I forgot. The secret. Damn, you know what that means? Gotta fucking re-go. It's this square, I believe. I thought the first secret wasn't until 16. No, okay, 13. Oh, I guess I gotta fucking launch fucking Crow all over here then. For a pile of bullshit. Avenkei's a badass, dude. They're all good boys. All them ghetto boys, good boys. Not a single bad ghetto boy. This ghetto guy, like, guy is like the worst ghetto boy. But he fulfills the requirement for being in the third ghetto, in that he's fat and stupid. He's gotta be fat and tough. Okay, if we get into this square, we meet. Look who it is! Smells dad. Whoa, whoa there! And then Crow, you alright? You need to get out of here. Sorry about that, I was looking for some parts down here and got myself stuck. At least you're alright, I'll cover you while you escape. Pete smiled. Thanks buddy, tell you what, this one's on the house, my thanks. And we get an auto repair machine. And then, I guess this thing means he's a repairman. But working in this burning wreck? Must be crazy about his job. I did, and I forgot that secret, but we got it now, so we're good. But it smells dad. That's where he's ended up this time. He ended up in this fuckhole world. Wing. can't believe that even hooting and hollering, she's still 3 short. Super God Beast combination. Big sword that guy. Nice work. Why did Ren supposed to be the thumb? Because he's the man who taught Ren how to pose that way. Womp. It's CeeLo Beta. Right in the dick. Fucking Ryoma, ruthless. It's the karate style. It's like the order of operations when they're attacking someone. It's like eyes, throat, balls, eyes, balls, eyes. That was most bad from Zero. What's he doing there? Swearing it up when he got fucking teleported, I guess. When the dimensional distortion came and yoinked him, that's where he went. Just ended up in this weird dimension. Oh. You guys ready? Yup. Fucking time, and you'll get there one day. One day, you'll be a good boy, and strong, and big, and real. This is how the SMS fight, by randomly shooting flak everywhere. And then Wata's gonna say something about... Yeah, he's like, I'm gonna kick your butt to a trainer, cause taking hostages is bad. Dick. Right in the dick. Bum 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 bum. Nice work, Wata. Doing it. You're like 5 or whatever. So, yeah, with the clan being that old 60 feet tall thing, the Cordelia Rao that she pilots is pretty much just like a power suit. It's like an oldie-timey diver suit kind of deal, but for flying around in space and murdering people. It's good as hell. We're just trying to come up with a list called Daitan. Do they share the same designer? Let's have a look. Because Daitan... like they were all done by sunrise. It's like Zambot, Daitan, and Trider are all of a thing. Just to remind you of Dragon Ball, because it looks like perfect. Nah, it's sort of, it's meant to look like the... Let me find you the original Kuodlun. Not the Kuodlun Rao. There's the Kuodlun Raya and there's the Kuodlun Rao. She's in the Kuodlun Rao and it became a Kuodlun Raya. Yeah, so she's in the Kuodlun Raya. But again, it's designs from like 88? No, it's before that. The movie was 88, it was before then, so. K is the number one ladies' man for all time. No one will ever out ladies' man that dude. Me, 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 God, these jokers. Here's the fucking line art of the original Kuodlun Rao, and for some reason, just if Milia's in it naked? Those classic artist people always drawing whenever they can. Classic. I don't know why they did that, but they did. Kishitobe is fly away, fucker. I don't know if it's like that, because I was showing what the robot clans robots based on of, and that was like the best picture of it, and also with somebody in it, and then also then also everything else in that picture for some reason. Real robots have curves. Actually, real robots traditionally are blocky pieces of shit. Got him. This fucking joke. I'll show you the strength of my resolve. Whiffs flak shots at a lady. Get the machine gun. Goddamn, get a machine gun. So good and pointless. Just completely pointless. He's got infinite tomahawks he can throw forever. Why does he need a machine gun? Other than it's cool, I guess. Our guns? I don't think guns do make you cool. Make a world safe for Nunnally. And then that leaves us in position to get the big gun boy if he decides to fight us, but he probably won't because he's a shitty baby. Is his upgrade just a standard frame with a shitty mask? Yes. His robot is exactly the same as Tamaki and Ogi's, but with the shitty mask on. Shimata! Oh no! Pure garbage. His ISC move is 2 to 4, whereas Osmus is 1 to 4. This is bullshit. Actually, I think it's only 1 to 4 when he's in people mode. I gotta skip turning up that because we've already played this stage twice. And I'm in hell. All because I needed to get that free cake. It's not even the cake, it's the auto repair cake. Robot cake. There. We did it. So we did it. And now we're like, oh wow. We must be pretty strong to be able to take out like the stuff that those guys had, and we're all together. And then Takeru is like, yes, but we must make sure to use our strength for good and not evil. And there's Ogi and Tamaki come up, and Zero's like, alright then, time for the next stage of the plan then. Now that the cameras are still rolling. And he yells, citizens! Fear us and pray to us! We are the Black Knights! Black Knights? And Lloyd is like, wow, terrorists like to call themselves knights, huh? How about that? He says, we, the Black Knights, we will fight in place of the powerless, whether they be Britannian or Eleven. The JIM took Britannian citizens hostages and threatened to kill them. It was a foolish act, so he passed judgment on them. And the former Viceroy Clovis was no different. He ordered the slaughter of powerless Elevens, who would not allow such villainy to stand. So, we passed judgment on him. Masaka, just kidding. I did not desire to fight, but when the strong slaughter the weak, we must act. Only those should shoot who are prepared to be shot themselves. We will come again when the strong oppress the weak. No matter how powerful our enemy should be, and not only in Japan, but anywhere on the planet. So let the strong fear us, and let the weak pray to us. We, the Black Knights, pass judgment on all the world. And everyone's like, holy shit, this dude. He's a wild guy. And remember, that's the complete opposite of Charles's announcement, where he's like, it's good that you're weak and you deserve to get bullied. Eat shit. Whereas this guy's like, equality for all. Everyone deserves to be safe. And owned by me. So, Zero then talks big to Otsuka that while he can't reveal how he freed the terrorists, it wasn't tough. The point here is that he wants to work with us. And it's part of his goal to be the good guys. I'm like, well, I mean, sure, we'll go with you. We were tied to the UN for official backing. We'll have boatmen to deal with the shady business. And we'll have lots of physical power to throw around everywhere. Pretty good. The commanders are having some doubts, though. But that's alright. Because Elgin Roddick walks in and is like, you're doing it. You're working together, alright? Circumstances forced his hand, and Zero guesses correctly that Elgin Roddick himself is a boatman. He's like, yeah, that's me. And everyone's like, holy shit, what? But it makes perfect sense. He had to orchestrate everything that happened so far and to get all the terrorists, office workers and everyone else on the same team. But if anybody knew it was a UN councilman that had reached out to Celestial Being, would be political suicide, dynamite, everything. It'd be the worst. So Roddick kept Zero, Otsuka and Sumeragi all in the dark. But he apologises like a gentleman, because he's a good guy. He says he wants the same thing as Zero, to do the right thing. He says everyone has their own idea of what that is, and his is peace and prosperity for all of humanity. But to do that, you do ultimately need power, so he's gathered all us together to work under the council. Zero asks him what he's really after, and Elgin says, is it so hard to believe, Zero? Or is your idea of right just an illusion, so you can't believe anybody else would honestly want to pursue it? And everyone's like, damn, stone fucking cold. Well, I guess Elgin's alright, he's a good boy. Guess we'll help him then. And, we need a name for our big dingoid group of idiots. And he's gonna call us Zexis for the Zet Extra International Savers. Pretty good. Pretty good. He's like, what does the Zet stand for? And he says, the Zet stands for the axis that is neither X nor Y, but neutral. Alright. And then he says, does anyone have a better idea? And they're allowed to rename it, but I mean, Zexis is fine. And there are other, like, you can do randomize, and he comes up with Strike Team Zet, Zephyrs, Zax, Project Zet, and a Japanese joke that he didn't say, but, you know, Zexis. And we can change it whenever we want, as far as I know. But he mutters that the future of humanity is in our hands. Zexis. In an unknown location, Alejandro is reporting to some unknown observers, and they've learned that Celestial Being, Zero, and the alternate Earthlings have joined the Council, that being the Macross people, and it says an alliance of the Embers of War is what Alejandro calls them. The Faced Observers are like, oh, I can't believe Vader went along with the plan. But they just go, well, maybe Vader's not always right. Because, you know, they disagree, so it must be wrong. It can't be right 100% of the time, even though it literally is. But as observers, they can only watch. So each of them approve the plan, whatever it is and whatever good it'll do them. And Alejandro puts his own plans in motion. And his plan is to guide the world on the right path. And we get a cartridge, a muscle cylinder, a precise lens, e-carbonara, a high-power radar, auxiliary ISC, which is the friggin' control thing, an adapter, a screw module, a land module, a space module, and a cake. And then we'll end the recording.